Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome as we come to worship on this day the Lord has made. Today we start the new church year. Happy New Year. And we start the season of Advent. Also, during the service, we will have anointing for healing. And you can come up for healing for any needs, physically, mentally, emotionally, or spiritually. With Advent, I thank all those through the next couple of weeks who will be lighting the candles during church service. It's greatly appreciated. And it just adds a little touch to the service. And hopefully next Sunday I'll remember, because I forgot to this weekend, to get the box down so you can bring your Christmas cards in to be delivered instead of having to spend the money. Stamps are getting so expensive. If you want to give Christmas cards to anybody in the church family, please bring them. Just make it sure it's someone that comes regularly so we can hand it out, so the Luther Lig doesn't get stuck with the postage. We want to continue to have prayers for Skip Petrie. Because of my family coming in today, I have 17 showing up for dinner today. There will be no Kids Club, Catechism, or Luther Lig this evening. And we'll begin again next Sunday. Reminder that next Sunday on December 5th, we'll be decorating the trees after worship. On the 7th of December, we'll have council meeting. Tentatively, we have scheduled for the 19th to be Christmas caroling. And a time is to be determined. I have a couple of times in my mind, but I want to get together with some of you faithful singers and find out what time works for all of you. And Christmas Eve is going to be two services this year. We're going to have Christmas Eve service at 4:30 and at 7 o'clock. So mark your calendars. If you can't come to one, I'm hoping you can come to the other. Are there any other announcements, concerns to come in front of the congregation? Yes, prayers for hunters, that everybody stay safe out in the woods this week. Started yesterday. I'm hoping they have a bountiful harvest because I don't like having to dodge them with my car. Any other announcements or concerns? And also keep prayers for all those traveling this weekend, going home and from the busy holiday weekend. At this time, let's prepare our hearts and our minds as we prepare for worship by listening to the prelude. Thank you. Please rise. We gather for worship as we should live our lives in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not with us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please kneel if you are able. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise as we join in singing hymn number 22. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. From the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
offer here their worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come that by your protection we may be rescued from the threatening perils of our sins, and saved by your mighty deliverance. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is recorded in Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter, the 14th to the 16th verse, this being the first Sunday of Advent. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will dwell securely. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. At this time, please turn in your blue hymnals to 630. As we sing one verse of Light the Candle.
Insert for the fullness of time. For centuries, God's people waited for a Savior to make his presence known.
But years passed without a sign.
But in the fullness of time,
Christ Jesus arrived on this earth.
From heaven he came to be with us.
He came just when we needed him most.
We who once were bound by sin for thousands of years since the fall of Eden
have now been set free from our bondage to sin by the birth of Christ.
Now is the time to be unshackled by guilt and shame, greed and anger,
and be free to live in forgiveness and joy, peace and love.
We are free to be the people of God, created in us to be and to use our time to his glory.
We celebrate the days we have been given through Jesus and look towards the day to come in heaven with him.
The second reading for this day is recorded in 1 Thessalonians, the 3rd chapter, the 9th to the 13th verses. What thanksgiving can we return to God for you, for all the joy that we feel for your sake before our God, as we pray most earnestly night and day that we may see you face to face and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all as we do for you, so that we may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel this morning, according to the Gospel of Luke, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "There'll be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth distress of nations and perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. For the power of heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." And he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they come out in leaf, you see for yourself and know that the summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all has taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But watch yourself, lest your heart be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, and that day come upon you suddenly like a trap. For it will come upon all who dwell on the face of the whole earth. But stay awake at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are going to take place and to stand before the Son of God." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Would the children come forth at this time? So what I say, what season started today? Advent. And I have a whole mess of these. I know you got yours already because we weren't sure if you were going to be here today. So we'll have to make sure they get out to everybody else. Usually I send out an Advent calendar, you know, that all the days of Advent. But this is something a little different. That's supposed to be Bethlehem, so that everybody can see back there. And it has from 1 to 25. So you start this on Wednesday, December the 1st. And when December 1st, you open the booklet to the first day. Well, let's say I open to December 8th. December 8th, you'll read Asleep in the Manger, and it's from Luke 2. And you read that passage, and then there's stickers in here. And you find the sticker for number 8 and put it on the number 8. So till Christmas comes, you'll have a full Bethlehem. And we're anxious to see what the picture looks like. So I want you to go and enjoy that. What color is Advent? You think so, huh? It's one of my favorite times to see the blue in the church, because blue is one of my favorite colors. So, do you know what blue represents? What's the first word hanging down in front of the Advent wreath? Hope. Blue is the color for hope. And this is the time of year we need a lot of hope, especially this year. We have a lot of things going on in the world. The days are getting shorter and shorter, and we just need to hold on to God and have a lot of hope. And we know that He is always with us through the short days, through the long days, through the good times, the bad times. We can always count on God being there and giving us hope. So let's fold our hands and bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for these children. We thank you that they are so faithful to you. Be with them through this Advent season. Let them find hope now and always. In your holy name we pray. Amen. I don't have any lollipops out because I'm going to give these out. So
I have special lollipops next Sunday, so you come on out for that one, okay? See you then.
Hope. What would life be without hope? To remember the hope you had as a small child, the hope that a big snowstorm would cancel school. I know many teachers that have never lost that hope. The hope of staying up all night on New Year's Eve and falling asleep by 10 o'clock. I still do that. The hope of a great summer and enjoying time with friends. There was a shoe manufacturer who sent two salespeople into a remote area that they had never serviced before. Shortly after arriving, the boss received an email from each salesperson. One salesperson wrote, "Get me out of here. No one here wears shoes." He had no hope of making a sale. The other salesperson wrote, "Send more inventory. Everyone here needs shoes." He was full of hope in the opportunity it showed of making a lot of sales. Hope is a theme for the first Sunday in Advent. Hope is an essential part of our life. What would life be like without hope? Studies have shown that patients who are critically ill recover more often when they are given hope. Life would be dark without hope, and that is where Christ comes in. The hope that Christ gives us lights up our lives. The color of Advent is blue, the color of hope. The blue, like we often see in our skies at this time of year, as the days grow shorter and shorter. But just like the light of dawn chasing away that blue sky, the hope of Advent leads us to the light of Christ Jesus. Hope is believing on promises made. Hear again these words from our first reading from Jeremiah that Miller read just a short time ago. "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah." What was the promise we are to have hope in? Hope is the promise of the Old Testament. In fact, it is the promise that fills the Old Testament. From the early chapters of Genesis, from the time sin enters the world, the promise was made that God was going to send them salvation, that a rescue plan was made that would put humankind back in relationship with God. This promise is repeated throughout the Old Testament, even a couple times just in the book of Jeremiah. The promise that God would have a righteous branch to spring up from the house of David. The promise that the one God would send, who would come from the lineage in the house of King David. The New Testament is fulfillment of the promise, and yet not quite. The New Testament shows us the life and teaching of Jesus Christ and the sacrifices of his life to redeem us all from our sins and to place us back in relationship with God, but not completely yet. In our gospel reading today, Luke repeats the story that we heard two Sundays ago in our gospel from Mark. Jesus tells the disciples that there will be signs in the sun, moon, stars, and earth. People will be overwhelmed with fear and foreboding. The disciples do not need to fear. Things are under control. Jesus had told them what will happen so that they know that these events can't catch God unaware. Quite the opposite. These events are part of God's plan. The world is moving to a conclusion when the Son of Man will return and establish his kingdom. The disciples and us need not fear. because Jesus is with them in the person of the Holy Spirit. They are not alone. God will take care of them, and God will take care of us. A frequent occurrence when I was going to school was a fire drill. The alarm would blare. We would line up two by two, and our teacher would lead us out of the building to an area we were assigned to. We'd wait for the all clear, that everyone got out of the building, and then we'd learn if we'd done it fast enough to survive a real emergency. The administration and the teachers didn't believe that a fire would ever occur, but they wanted everyone to know what to do if a fire did break out in the building. The old saying, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, was in effect. When people are fearful, Christians can shine brightly by their calmness, peace, faith, and hope that can only come from faith in Jesus Christ. In the midst of upheaval, the life of a Christian will be different from those who are not followers of Jesus Christ. Christians live within a paradox. Jesus tells his disciples that no one will know when the Son of Man will return. Then moments later, he tells his disciples that they should keep watch. Jesus points out to the fig tree. When it begins to sprout leaves, the time of the coming of the Son of Man will be near. The fig tree was the last sprout that came out, proclaiming that summer was near. Christians are to be aware of what is going on around them. Their heads can't be in heaven and focus on heavenly things, so that they are not knowledgeable of current events. But knowledge of events is not necessarily enough. Christians are also challenged to see these events through the eyes of faith and understand them according to what Jesus has spoken. At the same time, Christians are not called to dwell on the coming of Jesus. We are not to speculate on when he will come, take office polls, or place bets. We live each day in the knowledge that the day might be our last. We live, we laugh, we love. We fully enjoy the gift that each day brings us. The word Advent means to come. And we go through these next 4 weeks waiting for the coming of the baby in the manger. But there is much more that we wait for. Christ came as the Word made flesh, as a Son of God, to save us. But that is not the end of the promise. It hasn't been fulfilled completely yet. Advent is a promise that Christ will come again to take us home with him. We live in this time with the kingdom of God all around us. We see the kingdom of God with kindness to others is shown. We see the kingdom of God when someone shares the word of God. We see the kingdom of God when there is love and not hate, when everyone agrees to get along no matter what their difference is, when someone reaches out to make another's life better. And yet, we wait for the time when we will live in the presence of God, when there'll be no more sorrow or pain. But until that time, we must stay hopeful and stay awake. For evil lurks around us, and we must stay vigilant. Our gospel reading tells us to watch ourselves, let our hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, so that we do not fall into a trap. Christians are able to do this because of what Christ has done on the cross. He has forgiven us and freed us. He has empowered us for mission, and he has assured us of his constant presence. Jesus tells his disciples that they are to be watchful. They are to be like the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts and be prepared. Jesus then gives them specific ways that they can be prepared. They are not to waste their time in extravagant eating, drinking, and be merry lifestyle. Such a lifestyle is selfish and self-centered. It is not what disciples of Jesus Christ are called to do. They are not to get drunk. Usually we drink to escape, and escape is not a part of the calling of a Christian. We are called to be engaged, like Jesus was engaged in our world, and in our lives. They are not to be weighed down with worries because of God's promise to care for us. We do not need to worry because God embraces us and cares for us. We do not need to be anxious. These traps keep us from watching and from being prepared. Our eyes are turned towards ourselves rather than towards God. Instead of drunkenness and anxiety, we are invited to be in prayer. In prayer, we receive strength to face life. In prayer, God assures us of his love. In prayer, we can experience the peace that is beyond all understanding. Like children who have gone through several fire drills, we are prepared. We may never have to practice what we are taught in those drills, but if a fire does break out, we will know what to do. Christ may not return in our lifetime, but if he does, we will know what to do, and we will be able to welcome him with open arms and open hearts. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please rise as we join in singing hymn number 35. Continue by confessing our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, you give us hope by fulfilling the promise of sending a Savior to us all. Let us wait for the child in the manger and for the return of Christ who will come in the clouds. Lord, in your mercy. Guiding Spirit, please give guidance and wisdom to church leaders. We especially pray for our Bishop Dan Salbo, his staff, and his wife Mary. We pray for our mission district.
Be with all pastors and lay people who stand on your word. Lord, in your mercy. King of the universe, we ask you to give wisdom and guidance to President Joe Biden. We ask for you to be with Governor Tom Wolf, with our legislators and local elected officials. May they all place their faith in you. Lord, in your mercy. God, our protector, be with all those serving in the military, especially those who are in harm's way. We also pray for first responders, our police officers and firefighters, along with those serving as EMTs and in the ERs. Lord, in your mercy. God of creation, be with all those traveling, whether by airplane, car, or train, during this holiday time. Guide them, we pray. We also ask you to be with all those traveling to hunting camps this week. Be with them and keep them safe as they bring in a bountiful harvest. Lord, in your mercy. Healing Spirit, be with those who need your healing hand, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. We especially pray for Skip Petrie, Charlotte Lohr, Carl Wilner III, Kathy Butler, Libby LaDuff, Bill Hood, Donna Birkebau, Carrie DeNorsey, Jeff Darr, Jane Helmers, Barry Moyer, Mark Huffman, and all those we name in our hearts before you now. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort, be with those who mourn and grieve for their loved ones. Give your comfort till the day we are all united in your heavenly home. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated and sing hymn number 532. All those who wish to be anointed for healing can come to the rail.
Now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now may Almighty God, who is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless us and guide us through this Advent journey and for all times. Amen. Please join in singing hymn number 31.